You have a classical masterpiece like Madame Bovary or Don Quixote or, you know, Flaubert of Descartes' writing. You have a classical masterpiece, and then you want to take that as the basis for a new retelling of that story, a telling that would be relevant for today instead of for the mid-19th century. And when you look for possibilities of doing that, you have constantly, you sort of almost bump into, like, mid-19th century? How did he know? Capitalism hadn't been, I mean, it was beginning, but it hadn't been theorized. Marx hadn't written Das Kapital, but he, Flaubert, staged it. He put it in the dialogues, in the storytelling, and so here we were, filmmakers for today. We want to send out this caution, this warning about how capitalism destroys the world, and that it does also destroy the emotional level of human beings. And how do we do that if we are going to make a film that is not based on faithful following of Flaubert, because that would be a huge mistake, and people have been making that mistake. It's based on a sort of innovative, maybe abductive, way of making that, give that actuality by showing how it actually works. And Flaubert did that. So there is a loyalty to what Flaubert did. Flaubert was very critical of his time, fiercely critical of his time. But that was his time. And if you now make a historical film that with long dresses and all that, you're actually being disloyal to Flaubert because you take away his contemporaneity. And so we had to put it in the present to be loyal to this historical figure. And that is very important in our work, that we make it pertinent, relevant for today. So the relationship between the pretext and the new text is one of loyalty, not faithfulness. Mm-hmm. And the difference, you get the difference, right? Faithful is like this restrictive sexual faithfulness. You cannot cheat on your partner. You have to stay with the same. And loyalty is understanding on a deeper level what the text, the pretext is doing, not what it's about, not what the story is, but what it's doing. And what it's doing is laying bare a social syndrome, the social syndrome of emotional capitalism. And that syndrome had to get shaped for today. And so that's why we had to go to a real designer store in Paris and not to some sort of, you know, a clothing department in the theater. It's a real store. And that makes it even more grippingly crazy, because that store is sort of over the top, and so it makes it possible to be loyal to the historical pretext and at the same time innovative, so that people today understand what the dangers are of this fun shopping. If you think of the term, well, half the world is starving and we go fun shopping, something wrong there. And that's something that I wanted to bring out. And also this basic indifference to who the guy is that she's going to sleep with, as long as she has the excitement, that is expressed by the choice of the casting of the same actor for the three roles. And that is also a social syndrome that we wanted to show. Now, that is not at all In the novel, there are three different men, and she goes from the one to the other because they get boring. But the fact that there is something identical in her infatuation that is based on this mistaken illusion of permanent excitement, that we wanted to bring out. And that we do that because Flaubert did it, but he did it differently. That's how the connection, and that's how the decision to base a project on that novel is also a decision to make the changes, to be unfaithful. And we learned that from the first fiction film that we did based on a psychoanalyst in Paris and her book. And she played herself in that film, so she was there all the time. And I was constantly nervous. I said, don't you feel that I'm betraying your book? She said, on the contrary, you're enriching it. And so I learned something about that connection from her, which was very reassuring, but lovely also for you. Yes. I think that the more enigmatic and strange and ambivalent an image is, the more possibility it offers for creative thinking on the part of the viewer. And some images have that more than others. There are some that are very, very straightforward. I have here this image of a wedding where the groom looks away from the bride and the bride looks totally sad with tears in her eyes. These people are unhappy. So it's not so difficult to guess that they are marrying because they have to, either because she's pregnant or because the parents insist, which was the case in the story, but they don't want to marry. And so there is a festive occasion that they don't want. And so the sadness there is an occasional sadness. There's something wrong. They're in the wrong place in the wrong time. And so that image is a beautiful image, but it's straightforward. You see the sadness. You have another image from the same film. This is the film on Don Quixote, where you see Don Quixote looking in the mirror. And the mirror image looks at you, looks straight at the viewer. It's a beautiful image made by a Norwegian artist, Jeanette Christensen, who is herself a photo artist, among other things. It's a beautiful image because what it does is it confronts his desire to know himself. Looking in the mirror is an attempt to know yourself. His hesitation, who am I? He has all these different names and, you know. It confronts that with his gazing out in the mirror image, straight at the viewer. So the viewer can put himself or herself in his place, also looking in the mirror. You look at a mirror image, it's a very interesting split. The photo is split right in the middle. It's a very interesting split of a self-examination. And I think that this image gives you the possibility to reflect on that. What is self-reflection? What does it mean to look in the mirror? What do you see? Is what you see you, or is what you see what others see? Basically, that's, you know, the theory of Jacques Lacan, that the mirror image is always false. It's, you never see yourself, you only see what others see. And having been raised as a girl in the time that girliness was a big thing, I was used to looking in the mirror and seeing how the guys in school would be looking at me. So I was looking as someone else. I remember that vividly, that I wanted to understand how they see me. And that is, of course, a form of alienation that I think the image makes possible to understand that.